Hello Vulkan developers! In the previous video we learned about descriptor indexing, which allows us to use a single descriptor set with a very large array of resources. This array is bound once and each individual vertex or fragment can dynamically access a different resource in it. For example, this allows us to use different textures for different segments of vertices without rebinding descriptor sets. As I've mentioned in the video, descriptor indexing is a milestone on the way to indirect rendering, which is the topic of today's video. Indirect rendering means that instead of issuing thousands of draw calls from the CPU, we can batch them into a single indirect command buffer and let the GPU handle culling, draw call generation, and resource selection dynamically. Let's do a quick recap of how we set up a model for rendering. A model is loaded using the SIMP library and may contain one or more meshes, where each mesh has a segment of vertices, a segment of indices, and potentially an index into an array of materials. Each material can contain several textures of different types. We create a single SSBO for all the vertices of the model, and concatenate all the vertex segments into it. We do the same thing for the indices. Before we had descriptor indexing, we used to create a descriptor set for each segment. This descriptor set would set up the offsets into the index and vertex SSBOs, so that each segment would access its own indices and vertices. In addition, the sampler 2D uniform in the fragment shader would be set up to point to the base color texture from the corresponding material, and the offset in the uniform buffer would be set up to point to the corresponding location in the uniform buffer so that each mesh could access its own WVP matrix. When recording the command buffer for the model, we traversed all the meshes, bound the descriptor set of the current mesh, and submitted a draw call for the number of indices in the current mesh. In the previous video, we took advantage of descriptor indexing for the first time, and we created a single descriptor set with an array of all the material textures of the model. This descriptor set was bound once before going over all the meshes. But since the vertex, index, and uniform buffers were still handled in the old way, we had to bind the descriptor set of the current mesh as usual. Textures were handled separately from the other resources, not for technical reasons, but primarily to reduce the amount of work and make debugging easier. To allow each mesh access to its own texture in the big texture array, we added a metadata SSBO with the material index for each mesh. We used the system-generated GL base instance in the vertex shader to access this SSBO and get the material index of the current vertex. This index was sent over to the fragment shader and was used to access the big texture array. Indirect rendering enables us to replace the loop of draw commands with a single draw command that points to a buffer. This buffer contains a vector of structures, where each structure basically provides the same parameters as the original draw call. This means that we can replace a potentially CPU-intensive loop with a GPU-driven workload which is supposed to be more efficient and scales better for large scenes. However, to make this work, we have to get rid of that per-mesh descriptor set, which is a leftover from the initial descriptor indexing work. We can easily move the handles of the vertex, index, and uniform buffers into the same descriptor set of the textures, which, I remind you, is bound once before the old draw command loop. But we have to somehow tell each mesh the offsets into these buffers so that the correct segments of vertices and indices, as well as any uniform variable, are used. The solution is the metadata SSBO. In the previous video, it was populated with an array of structures, where each structure provided a material index the base index, the number of indices, and the base vertex of a single mesh. All this information is already available when we load the model, so it's very simple to populate this SSBO. In the previous video, we only used the material index, but now we're going to use the other pieces of information as well. We can see that in the vertex shader. We take the index offset from the metadata structure, divide it by the size of an index in bytes, and the result is the base index. We use this base index when accessing the index SSBO. So previously, the base offset in this SSBO was set up by the descriptor set, but now the base offset is always zero, so we have to manually calculate the base index. The vertex buffer is handled in a very similar way, maybe a bit more complex. We have to divide the vertex offset from the metadata, which is in bytes, by the size of the vertex. So the denominator here is the number of floating points in the vertex structure times the number of bytes in a floating point, which is of course 4. The base offset in the uniform buffer is also 0, so we replace the single WVP matrix with an array of matrices. We access the correct matrix using the draw index, which is the base instance. Notice that we have to specify the size of the uniform array. I'm using 1K here because the maximum size of a uniform buffer on my machine is 64K and the size in bytes of a WVP matrix is 64. There's no problem using fewer uniform variables here, but if the model has more meshes, we have to replace the uniform buffer with an SSBO. To reduce the amount of work, I decided to stick with the uniform buffer for now. Making the above changes to the descriptor set layout requires a lot of changes to the graphics pipeline class, which is why I created yet another version of this class, graphics pipeline v4. Let me just point out the main changes in this class, and you can compare it to the previous version, v3, if you need more details. First of all, we can see that the second descriptor layout for the textures is gone, and we are back to a single layout for all the resources. This is similar to the first two versions of this class. The interface of the class for allocating and updating the descriptor sets is also simpler. Instead of a vector of vectors of descriptor sets, where the outer dimension is for the submeshes and the inner dimension is for the images, we just need one dimension for the images. Remember that we still need a uniform buffer for each image, so a vector is still required. Getting rid of the second layout means that all the resources are now in the same set: a vertex buffer, an index buffer, a texture sampler, a uniform buffer, and a metadata buffer. When updating the descriptor sets, we set the descriptor buffer info of the vertex and index buffers to have an offset of 0, and the range is vk whole size. The new descriptor layout and set are ready, so we can take a look at the changes in the vk model class. This class includes a new private attribute for the indirect buffer. At the end of the createBuffers function, if descriptor indexing is enabled for this object, this is a new parameter from the previous video, we create the metadata buffer as well as the indirect buffer. We need to prepare a vector of the drawIndirect command structure. This structure is defined in the Vulkan SDK, of course, so no problem. The size of the vector is the same as the size of the meshes vector. The vertex count is set to be the number of indices of the current mesh. Somewhat confusing, but remember that we are using vertex pooling, so we submit a non-index draw call, and we do the indexing inside the vertex shader. So the vertex shader will be executed based on the number of indices. The instance count is 1, and the first instance is the index of the current mesh. We're not doing instancing here, we just used gl-base instance to get the mesh index. The first vertex is always 0. As we've seen, the base vertex is calculated in the vertex shader using the metadata. I guess you can use this guy as an alternative, but I haven't tried it. You can try it yourself and let me know if it works. We can now create the indirect buffer and populate it with the vector. This is a new wrapper function in the Vulkan core, which calls createBufferInternal with the usage flag bit indirectBuffer. We used to create buffers with a hard-coded usage flag storage buffer, but since the creation of the indirect buffer and the SSBO are almost the same, I refactored out this function and we have the two wrappers for the SSBO and the indirect buffer. Each wrapper provides its own usage bit, and then the rest of the code is basically the same. The indirect buffer is ready, so we can take a look at a new function which records the indirect draw command. First, we bind the descriptor set for the current image. Since the class maintains backward compatibility with the previous tutorials, the descriptor set attribute is still a vector of vectors. The outer dimension is for the meshes, so we use 0 here. We can now call cmdDrawIndirect. The parameters are the command buffer, the handle of the indirect buffer, 0 is the base offset in the buffer. This allows you to pack several vectors of the vkDrawIndirect command structures into the same buffer. We don't do that, so the offset is 0. Next, we have the number of elements in the vector, and finally, the stride between consecutive elements in the vector. This allows you to pack more stuff between elements, but since we don't do that, the stride is simply the size of an element. Last, but certainly not least, we have to enable the feature. When we create a logical device in the Vulkan Core class, we have a physical device feature structure, which is pointed to by the device create info structure. We have to set the multiDrawIndirect member to true. And this is it. If everything went well, the final image should look exactly the same. And that's it for today. Thank you for watching, and I will see you next time.